Metodología React into the Past. 3D para Second Life. Explosiones de rayos gamma. Esto define a la perfección a Anthony Crider, experto en la metodología React into the Past, director del Departamento de Física de la Universidad de Elon y Digital Learning for the Reacting Consortium of College and Universities. Ha escrito un juego de la serie Reacting, El debate Plutón, la Unión Internacional define un planeta. También encabezó el proyecto NSF sobre el uso de Reacting en enseñanza de las ciencias. Su interés por la visualización de la ciencia le llevó a crear los planetarios virtuales, telescopios y paisajes lunares en el mundo en línea 3D de Second Life. Tony recibió su PhD en física espacial y la astronomía de la Universidad de Rice y continuó su investigación de las explosiones de rayos gamma como un asociado del Consejo Nacional de Investigación en el Laboratorio de Investigación Naval. Todo esto y más veremos a continuación con Anthony Crider.
Me and Anthony Crider, and today I'm going to talk to you about my true passion, technology, which I have had this passion for technology since Star Trek, The Next Generation. When I was a kid, I loved the technology on the Enterprise. That had the pad, these ultra-thin computers. Do you remember those? See? Or do you remember the games that you could wear on your head and it would send the game into your eye? I have a secret, vivimos en el futuro. Here's the iPad and here's the Google Glass, el mismo de Star Trek The Next Generation. Pero when I was watching the show as a kid, I wondered, what about the classroom of the future? The Star Trek Enterprise had a classroom of the future. What would that look like? And when I became a professor, I decided I wanted to build that. El aula del futuro. At American University, I tried to do that, except for it's not the future, it's 2002. But this was based on the scale-up model that Bob Buechner had created at North Carolina State University. And I had almost exactly the same classroom in the basement of the science building, but with Macs rather than PC, because me gusta Macs. And so it's the tables that are around, multiple projectors, but two pillars in the room that made it kind of a problem. As I was going on, I wanted to try more and more technology, the same sort of clicker questions that Derek Brough talked about yesterday. I was trying in my astronomy classes. I also taught a class here in Mexico. Hace dos años enseñé una clase de astronomía en México, Maya Moderno. This is a program called Starry Night, and my students took panoramas, one photograph at a time, because you had to do one photograph, and then put them together on the computer. Now with an iPhone, you take the one picture. Then they put it in to see cómo se las estrellas para los Maya hace mil años. And that was a fun thing to do. I eventually wanted to push it as far as I could. I built a telescope virtual in Second Life, which was a virtual world, to teach my students in my astronomy classes how to use a telescope. What I learned was it's easier to teach students how to use the telescope itself rather than to teach them how to use a virtual reality. It was just a lot easier, and fix the telescope after they break it. I experimented a little bit as well with putting on videos to teach students so that they would break fewer of my telescopes by seeing how it works before they showed up with YouTube. And all these things are great things, but it put an idea in my head, a question that they talked about in the just a few minutes ago. Si es posible hacerlo en internet, la gente lo hará en internet. It will be done online. What will you do in the classroom if you've already had the whole lecture done at home? You'll be replaced unless you have something new and interesting to do, exactly as our previous speakers told us. What will you do when the robot comes up to replace you. Today I'm going to talk about two things. Dos cosas piensen, they're a good idea to keep your job, something the robot can't do. El primero es reacting to the past. They're games that you can use to help your students learn the material. This was created in Columbia University in New York City. Professor Mark Carnes started this off, but it's not a lecture. It's not like this at all. In fact, you don't have a professor for a reacting game. You have un maestro de juega, like a Dungeons and Dragons, where they roll the dice. But you don't play against dragons. You play using actual classic texts. You'll have your students read Plato or read Confucius and then pretend to be people in ancient Athens or people in ancient China debating what is the meaning of these great texts. I got into it with the Trial of Galileo game. There are many games that are published. Here's the series that's out now. These are the student manuals. So the students will buy the actual book, but they will also buy these instructions to understand the game. One of my favorites, like I said, is the Trial of Galileo. You don't need to play in a church, but I prefer it because it has a certain feel. So at the top, El Papa, you know, he feels much more powerful in a church than he would in a classroom. Also, when I play the Threshold of Democracy, a game about ancient Athens and the birth of democracy, if the weather is good, I play in the amphitheater. What's interesting is this student. Este estudiante es un estudiante de la escuela secundaria. No es un estudiante de mi universidad. He was visiting to decide, should I be a student at Elon or some other college? He played our game. I gave him a role. He did really well. And afterwards, he said, this is the best class ever. This is so much different than high school. I'm coming to Elon because every class will be like this. And I did not have the heart to tell him, no, not every class, not every class is a role-playing game. Here's what students look like when they're reacting. They're not sitting still. They're not listening to a lecture. When I actually record what they're doing in the classroom and measure every single second that they speak, I see the conversation bounce around from student to student. Now, some students are more talkative and some students are less, but they're arguing, they're writing papers, they're presenting their ideas and trying to win, because this is a game that you can win. You have teams. You are either a team that likes Galileo or a team that wants to burn Galileo at the stake. So here are the key pieces of reacting to the past games. Like I said, you know, the classic texts. They're set at key moments in histories. The students will debate, they'll write papers. And on un clase de 30 students, hay dos o tres o cuatro estudiantes indeterminate. Students that are undecided, that don't know which side to be on. So students on one team are trying to convince them to vote for them, and students on the other team are saying, no, vote for us, you know, burn Galileo. The students play to win. By the end of the class, our studies show they care more about winning than they do about their grade. Think for a moment, grades that we give them are an artificial thing. We make them up to have students work hard. But we are motivated to do things without grades. And one of the ways that humans are motivated is competition. Reacting to the past uses competition instead of grades as the primary motivator to get students to read Plato, Confucius, Galileo. Research by psychologists shows that students are different after they play these games. This particular plot shows the strongest reaction, where after a reacting game, students are more likely to be able to think people are able to change. that you aren't born one way and that way your entire life. If you pretend to be somebody else for 5 weeks, you start to feel what their shoes are like, to think that you could imagine what it would be like to be somebody else. So the students are more empathetic, they understand other people better, and they understand that people can change. Those are all things that we expect and hope for university students. Students also send emails or write us in their student evaluations that they're obsessed with these games, that they feel like they're working a lot on them because they want to win. Likewise, they feel like it engages them with the material, that they have to not just stand up and make a presentation, but be prepared to defend that presentation when other students attack you, when other students have a presentation that's the opposite. Mark Carnes recently put his book out on this, Minds on Fire, if you're reading a little bit more about the motivation behind this series, that it just came out this fall. And there are many, many, many games. Here are the ones that are published, but there are hundreds of games that are being developed and available online that you can try out on many, many different topics. If you want, you can create an account at rtp.org, and that'll allow you to look at the materials for instructors to see if there's a game that matches up with classroom content that you're interested in. You can also, how many of you have Facebook accounts? Todos? No? See? I say siento profesores and instructors that are in this secret group or quasi-secret group where you can talk with just other professors to see if there's a good game for you or if you need help. You can get it there usually within 1 or 2 minutes because there's so many people that are professors that are a part of that site. I have my own game that I wrote about La Planeta Plutón. And after this conference, or after this talk, there's a workshop that I'll be doing where if you want to argue as Pluto uno planeta o no, you can come over to that workshop. I'll give you one of the roles of the scientists, like Neil deGrasse Tyson, and you can argue with other people during that workshop. Reacting is a good thing for helping students learn the material, and you can take notes about how well they present their debates in class, and you can grade their papers the same as any other paper. But what I want to talk about next is a different way to assess students. Very often, how many of you give a test at the end of the semester? Almost everyone. We almost always do that on the last day. So the very last thing you say to your students is, bye. Have a good summer. I like you. That's very sad to me. When that happened to me 6 years ago, and I said, I will never do that again. I will never have a whisper be the last sentence I say to my students. I wanted something better, and I was inspired by my friend, an art historian, who gave an exam like this. She showed the painting and said, for 3 hours, write a paper about that painting. Increíble. It's the most simple exam. That's easy to make up, you know, and I'm like, yeah. I want an exam that is that awesome. Quiero escribir los examen final más increíble en la historia de los exámenes. Sí, es verdad. Y esta clase, Life in the Universe, a class about aliens, is where I have attempted to make that epic, amazing, awesome final exam. There are 21 students, 2 professors, me, un profesor de astronomía, y el otro profesor, un profesor de filosofía. And This student doesn't look that bright, but these are some of the most intelligent kids at our Elon campus. They're very, very smart. And so for one semester, we talked about SETI, the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence. And there are three primary books and topics that we covered. A novella, Contact, written by Carl Sagan, which is sort of half fiction and half nonfiction. The Equation of Frank Drake, which predicts if I have, you know, this many stars, you know, cuantos estrellas y cuantos planetas de estrella y cuantos planetas tienen vida, you know, how many intelligent aliens are in our galaxy Milky Way. And the third thing was the paradox of Enrico Fermi, saying, if there are so many aliens, why haven't we seen them yet? So this is the core of the class. We wanted an exam that would push them to the limits and test all the things that they'd learn. But the only thing we told them was, there is an exam, and please wear comfortable shoes. We refused to tell them anything else about it. You know, it was a mystery. Often students will complain if they don't know all the details of an exam, like how many questions, and is what type of question. But students also like a mystery. They want the fantastic. And so by refusing to tell them anything, they bought into it. They didn't ask because they wanted to be surprised. And they were. Because when they walked in, no profesores, no sillas, no mesas, solamente cuatro cámaras en cuatro rincones, and this. Do you recognize what that is? Hay una película, 2001, A Space Odyssey. And this was the alien from the movie 2001, A Space Odyssey. So for 2 hours, we recorded to see what would they do. No pregunta, no instructors, solamente that. ¿Qué harías? What would you do? What would you do if you walked into that room? That's what they did, actually. They touched it, take a selfie. They thought I was inside of it. So they knocked on it. They called their friends. Oh my God, mom, take a look at this. This is our final exam. For 30 minutes, it was utter chaos. And then they got serious. One group went across the campus with their shoes, comfortable shoes, to look for an otro monolito. The others, a small group of mathematics students, stayed in the room to look for clues. Hay uno estilo rojo, y cuatro estilos negro, y nueve estilos azul. ¿Qué es eso? You know, it's 1, 4, 9. It's 1 square, 2 square, 3 square. It's the size, the dimensions of that box. That was a clue I left for them. After 1.5 hours, they did what every university president would dream of. They knocked the table over, sat around it, and had a discussion. How are we different now than we were on the first day? What did we really learn in this class? This is exactly the sort of question that administrators and provosts want to know. And no one asked them that, but they asked each other how they were different. Do you believe that there are aliens? Why? What evidence was there? So for 30 minutes, there was this great discussion. And then they did something that surprised us. We filled that thing half full of cement, so they would not move it, and they moved it anyway. With ventos estudiantes, they were able to move it. They moved it down outside and set it up for all the other students at the school to see. A. They got an A for that part. There was a second part, though, because I was worried. The other professor, Anthony Weston, was comfortable with this exam, but I wanted an exam where I could at least predict a little bit, how am I going to grade it? This was the open-ended part. The next part is multiple choice. They showed up, two vans took them to this house, the garage door opens, and at the door, mis tres pollos. Enseño los pollos para ir a la puerta cuando está abierto. The students open the door, and three chickens run up to them. There's also food on the table. Tres pizzas de queso, tres pizzas de barbacoa pollo, y sunflower seeds. I don't know the word for sunflower seeds. Okay. I can't even hear. What would you do? What would you do if you saw this? One student said, and we played the tape back. We recorded this with a tape, and we played the tape back three or four times, and we heard him say to himself, I think this is a test. I think we're supposed to do something with the chickens. Do chickens eat sunflower seeds? Maybe we should eat sunflower seeds with the chickens. Another girl said, No, this is not an exam. This is a pizza party. The test is over. Let's eat. And in 2 minutes, the pizza was all gone. Indeed, we'd hoped that they would act a certain way, that they would treat the chickens as if they were extraterrestrials, that this was the extraterrestrial planet. Why would we expect them to do that? Well, 2 weeks before, we had another role-playing exercise where half of the class was playing astronauts, and I worked with them, and the other professor worked with the other half of the class to create a planet of extraterrestrials. And my astronauts would interact with his extraterrestrials. They called themselves the Kick Astronauts. That's a funny thing in English, if you say it out loud. So here they are in their spaceship, looking at the monitors, at a team that is visiting the other planet. Here is the other planet. It's very warm. It has many trees. There's a fire in the center. None of the aliens speak English. They're small, the size of a cat, but actually more like lizards. And they try to understand these aliens. What's the first thing you think my astronauts did? They captured one, brought it back to the ship, and ran experiments on it. Eventually, the Kick Astronauts captured several of the extraterrestrial students, decided that since they did not speak English, that they would make pets out of them and sell them on Earth so that they could fund missions to explore more planets. And they were happy. They were literally dancing after that exercise. We won! Awesome! The extraterrestrial students were extremely sad, literally crying, because their civilization, their months of work, were destroyed or ignored by our civilization. And so after the game was over, we talked about it. How many times has this happened in la historia de humano? How many times do humans do this to other humans, where the person with technology is able to destroy the person, the civilization, without technology? And they agreed, we will never treat other people that way. We will always treat other creatures with respect. And yet, when it came time for the Animal Planet exam, they ate alien pizza in front of the aliens. That's a C. We were trying to figure out how to grade this, and one question that a student asked another student during the first part came back into our mind. How do students change from all these interesting experiences that they have in the class? How would they be different on the first day and the last day? And so we created a rubric to decide what's appropriate. Like level zero, nivel cero, don't kick my chicken. Don't do something inappropriate. Versus, at the high levels, they're able to do things not just in the classroom, but what they learned, it's in their heart. And they will use it in places outside of the classroom after they're done. But as we wrote that, I told my friend, we will never be able to test it. We'll never be able to see what they do outside of the classroom because they're outside of the classroom. Another friend, Nick Proctor, told me, this is really amusing, but no one is going to be able to come up with an exam that's as crazy as yours. But then he made it an even crazier exam where students came in and had a piece of paper in front of them where the first six people to leave the room get a C. And entonces, the siete get a B, y the ultima seis get an A. And it worked, that they actually did this. Some students left early because they just didn't want to be there, and so they started to write their paper about it. Some students left and got a B. They thought, well, this isn't real. I'm not going to really get a B. They did, but they didn't think so. The students that got an A said to themselves in the papers, I am so glad I tricked those B students to leave early. Now I have an A. But still, we weren't happy. How do we find out if students are different after our class? Outside of the class, in their dormitory, in their homes. And here was the secret part of that class, a class about alien communication. For the whole semester, in fact, for a year before the class, every email that I sent to the students that would be in that class had this at the bottom. It's Morse code. I'll translate it. Espero es el proper nombre. Eso es Profesor Moradillo. ¿Conozco este nombre? They saw that clue from the game Clue, but didn't really know what it was. They thought it was just random. They ignored it. So then I asked former students from 2 years ago during their own presentations to give a talk with another secret message where, soy Profesor Moradillo, es Violeta, y el otro profesor es Profesor Green, y escribí un libro, Imagining the Green Revolution. And they figured it out. My students showed up to my class in the clothes of the characters from Clue. They didn't tell me that they figured it out. They decided to get a little even and show me. But the problem was they spent hours and hours and hours figuring it out. And then they thought, that was a lot of work. And it wasn't a big message. It was just a little thing. And they wanted revenge. And when honor students want revenge, they figure out how to get it. So those were my three pieces to my puzzle for them. A few days later, outside the door of my office, there was this note, which I recognized as from a video game. And that green dot is the green dot of Lo Otro Profesor, Professor Green. And that led me to his office, where there's a chessboard, which had a note that said this, but that translates to Irizu, the nombre de my coffee shop. So I went to the coffee shop, and there's another message that leads me up to the observatory, and on the observatory there's a card from the game Monopoly and lettuce, very, very stale lettuce, which led me to the greenhouse, which led me to a table with stones on it in prime numbers. And I looked under that table, and here was the last piece of paper. Can you read that? It's in Georgian, it turns out. It takes a long time to translate Georgian into English. How are you even going to type it? What does it say? That was it. They had their revenge. They had sent me a message, but their message was not the one that they thought that they sent me. Because I realized they were different. They were taking things that I had taught them and using them outside the class for a project that I did not tell them to do. They were doing it for fun. They were taking the time to figure out communication in a way that that I'd hoped that they would think about, and working on it for many more hours than I ever asked. If you're interested, there are two papers that I've got on the topic that are on my website. One of them is about reacting to the past and about how I ended up creating the Pluto debate. And the other one is about the educational activities that we created for the class with extraterrestrials. So you can take a look at those there. I still love technology. Here is a recent project that I had students create for a reacting to the past game that you could play online with a virtual Manchester from 1616, or from 18, sorry, from 1812. And you could put on the clothes of the person of the time and go from building to building. And I got my Oculus Rift recently, and so I've been exploring how to go inside these virtual worlds, just like you would with a holodeck in Star Trek. And these are great technologies. These will transform how we teach in the years to come. But for today, por ahora, I think that the Aula del Futuro, it's the classroom that you have, but a willingness to look a little silly, to play a few games, and to engage your students in a way that you might not have thought possible prior to that. Gracias por tu tiempo. Thank you very much.